In this module, we will review the various organ systems within the human body. Once completed with this module, you should be able to distinguish between the various body organ systems within the human body. To assist us in the study and understanding of the body and how it functions, it is common to evaluate the anatomy and physiology of the body's various organs in conjunction with other organs that serve like or similar functions. The compilation of organs into groups that serve very specific and related functions creates several recognized body organ systems. Within the following slides, we will identify the various organ systems within the human body, list the organs within those systems, and define the overall purpose or function of the respective systems. Before we begin exploring the individual systems denoted in this graphic, keep in mind that this particular module provides just a brief overview of these various systems. Each individual human body organ system is very complex, and we will explore these individual systems in significant depth in later modules. For the time being, however, this module will provide just a cursory overview of the individual organs that comprise these various systems, along with the major functions of these organ systems. The skeletal system of an adult consists of 206 bones and other connective tissues, such as cartilage, ligaments, and tendons, that serve several important functions within the body. First of all, the skeletal system provides a framework and structural support for the body. Without bones, our bodies would be just lumps of tissue. The skeletal system is the framework upon which the rest of the body is built. Given the inclusion of the body's muscular system, the skeletal system and the joints between the various bones also provides for mechanical leverage to move and perform work. In one of our earlier modules, we even looked at the physics of how the muscles in our body work with bones and joints to form levers that allow us to lift patients and move our bodies. Many of the organs within our body are relatively soft and, without some type of protection, would be easily damaged by external forces. Our bones provide much-needed protection for our various internal organs like the brain, heart, lungs, spleen, kidneys, and so on. The skull, vertebrae, rib cage, and pelvic girdle all form protective cages, if you will, to protect the organs that lie within them. The next three functions of the skeletal system are somewhat related and are often overlooked, especially by people without any formal medical training. Our bones store chemicals and minerals that are critical for the functioning of the body, such as calcium phosphate and lipids. Bone cells need calcium, and the bones themselves can store calcium and release it into the bloodstream when necessary. Another critical function of the bones in the skeletal system is the creation of various blood cells within the bone marrow. Do not worry too much about the details of these processes yet. This is just a high-level overview, and more details will be provided in later modules. The muscular system consists of more than 600 voluntary muscles and connective tissue, tendons in particular, which attach muscle to bone, that are responsible for the movement of the body, stability of our joints, and generating heat to keep us warm. We also have numerous involuntary muscles that perform specific functions in other body systems, such as the smooth muscles of the gastrointestinal tract in the digestive system, the diaphragm in the respiratory system, and cardiac muscle, the heart, within the circulatory system. When we refer to the muscular system in the context of paramedic training, we are referring specifically to voluntary muscles responsible for movement, joint stability, and heat generation. These other muscles will be discussed as necessary within their related organ systems. The respiratory system consists of the respiratory tract for oxygenated air movement into and out of the system, respiratory membranes where oxygen and carbon dioxide gas exchange occurs, the lungs, and several muscles that drive pressure differentials in the system to move air into and out of the body, such as the diaphragm, intercostal muscles in the chest wall, and other accessory muscles of the muscular system. As you will learn later, oxygen is critical for our cells, and the respiratory system serves the very important function of introducing oxygenated air into our bodies. The respiratory system also removes carbon dioxide, the waste product of cellular metabolism, from our bodies, while also including features that help prevent disease, assist in the control of the acid-base balance within the body, and allow us to vocalize, whether that be speaking, singing, grunting, or however we decide to make noise or communicate with others. While all of the organ systems within the body are critical for our continued survival, the circulatory system receives a lot of focus within paramedic education, as the circulatory system contains the heart and other related organs or components, such as our blood and the body's distribution system for that blood through various vessels, including arteries, arterioles, capillaries, venules, and veins. The heart is essentially a mechanical pump that moves blood around the body through a complicated distribution system simply referred to as our blood vessels. This blood carries much-needed oxygen, obtained through our respiratory system, to our various body tissues while removing the waste products of cellular metabolism, such as carbon dioxide. The pressure supplied to the circulatory system by the heart not only moves the blood through the vessels, but it also aids in tissue perfusion, whereby oxygen molecules cross permeable barriers to enter cells for energy production. Yes, it is much more complicated than that, but we will worry about those details in a later module. The blood also carries nutrients, carbohydrates, proteins, and fats obtained through our digestive system to feed our body's tissues, and it removes metabolic waste products away to the renal and respiratory systems for excretion from the body. The circulatory system works with the endocrine system to regulate the body by distributing chemical hormones released by the organs within the endocrine system throughout the body. The circulatory system also plays an important role in the regulation of our body's internal temperature by increasing circulation to the surface of the body to dissipate heat or decreasing circulation to the surface of the body to retain heat. The blood within the circulatory system also carries defensive cells and antibodies to protect against infection and foreign organisms, while also carrying platelets that stop bleeding and help repair the skin. The lymphatic system is actually considered part of the circulatory system. It consists of lymphatic vessels, the thymus, and the spleen. The lymphatic system both removes excess fluid from tissues of the body while also recovering fluid as necessary to maintain a proper balance of water within the body. It also produces and circulates lymphocytes, which are critical for maintaining the body's immunity against disease, illness, and infection. Lastly, the lymphatic system also carries various products, like nutrients and some hormones, that are unable to enter the bloodstream directly. The immune system also relies upon bone marrow to produce specific types of lymphocytes. Rather than delve into too many details here, the body's immune system response and how it functions will be discussed in greater depth in a later module. The nervous system is critical for the functioning of the human body and is actually divided into two separate categories: the central nervous system, which consists of the brain and the spinal cord, and the peripheral nervous system, which includes spinal and peripheral nerves, along with sensory organs like the eyes, ears, and nose. Through a complicated system of electrical impulses and chemical exchanges, the nervous system monitors the body's internal environment as well as the external environment. The nervous system integrates all of this various sensory information and coordinates the body's voluntary and involuntary responses to those various inputs to maintain a state of homeostasis within the body. As a simple example of this coordination of body responses to environmental changes perceived by the nervous system, the nerves in the skin may sense it is cold outside, while nerves inside the body also sense that the body's temperature is dropping. This in turn causes the nervous system to tell the circulatory system to constrict peripheral blood flow to conserve heat in the body's core. If the temperature within the body falls enough, the nervous system tells the muscles to rapidly contract and relax, otherwise known as shivering, to generate heat in an attempt to warm the body. The integumentary system is the largest and most visible system of the human body, as it consists predominantly of our skin, along with some accessory structures such as hair, nails, and glands that produce either oil or sweat. This system serves as the interface between the body's interior and the external world or environment. As a result, it should be no surprise that the integumentary system serves as protection for the body's various organs from external conditions like temperature extremes or radiation, such as that from the sun, or other invaders that could cause illness or injury, such as mechanical forces, various types of chemicals, or microorganisms and pathogens. In the previous slide on the nervous system, we talked about the body's response to cold. The integumentary system plays a very critical part in the body's ability to regulate its temperature. Humans are warm-blooded mammals that sustain their own internal body temperature and do not tolerate extremes in heat or cold. Being hyperthermic, too hot, or hypothermic, too cold, can indeed result in death. The integumentary system works with the circulatory and nervous systems to regulate body temperature by either constricting or dilating blood vessels in the skin to help the body either retain heat or expel heat, respectively. In hot environments, the integumentary system also produces sweat that, when it evaporates, cools the body as well. Dehydration of the body is also a very real concern, and the integumentary system serves as a vapor barrier, or watertight seal, of sorts, to help the body's internal environment retain water. Without the skin, internal organs would dry out rapidly. This is actually a consideration for fluid replacement therapy for burn victims. With the skin significantly burned and damaged, the body loses water at an alarming rate. The integumentary system is critical to preventing rapid dehydration of internal body organs. The skin contains a vast network of sensory nerves that provide feedback to the brain as to external environmental factors that can include heat, cold, pressure, pleasure, and pain. These sensations are vital for the brain to react in a fashion that protects or sustains the body. The integumentary system also has the ability to affect repairs through an inflammatory response in coordination with the circulatory system, which also carries platelets that can stop bleeding. Simply stated, the digestive system processes the food we eat and the beverages we drink to provide our bodies with energy and nutrition. As far as the digestive system's organs are concerned, the system is broken up into two main categories. The first is the alimentary canal, which is essentially a series of muscular tubes that are designed for moving and processing food within the body. From beginning to end, the alimentary canal includes the mouth, pharynx, esophagus, stomach, intestines, rectum, and anus. The second main category of digestive system organs are those that are considered to be accessory digestive organs. These accessory digestive organs include the teeth, tongue, salivary glands, liver, gallbladder, and pancreas. As just stated, the purpose of the digestive system is to process our food and drink to provide the body with energy and nutrition. This begins with ingestion, which is the process of bringing food and drink into the digestive system through the mouth. Within the mouth and tongue work together to chew the food into smaller pieces, while salivary glands produce enzymes that begin to break down the food. This mechanical processing continues within the stomach and intestines as the food continues to be mixed with fluids produced by the body to chemically break down the food for absorption into the circulatory system. This chemical breakdown of food is called digestion. The introduction of those various fluids into the digestive process, such as water, acids, enzymes, and buffers, is referred to as secretion. Secretion occurs within both the digestive tract and some of the accessory organs. At some point, the food is broken down within the digestive system to the point where organic substrates, electrolytes, vitamins, and water are absorbed through the digestive tract into the body. Lastly, any pieces of food that cannot be digested are excreted as feces through the process of defecation. The endocrine system consists of several organs, including the hypothalamus, pituitary gland, thyroid gland, parathyroid glands, thymus gland, pancreas, adrenal glands, pineal gland, and the gonads, ovaries in women and testes for men. These various organs are responsible for metabolic regulation within the body through the use of hormones. While our nervous system does a pretty good job of also regulating the functions within the body to maintain homeostasis, the biggest limitation of the nervous system is that it relies upon physical nerves, which can only impact those areas of the body in which they are in contact. As a result, the nervous system only reaches a portion of the body. In contrast, the hormones released by the endocrine system are distributed throughout the body through the circulatory system. These hormones function at the cellular level and have the ability to impact all areas of the body. To compare further, the nervous system is recognized as being good at crisis management, where quick action is required within the body to maintain homeostasis. The endocrine system also works to maintain homeostasis, but its activity is often considered to be slower and more long-term. The organs of the renal or urinary system include the kidneys, ureters, bladder, and urethra. These organs function together to control the body's fluid balance, filter and eliminate wastes, and control the acid-base balance within the body. The kidneys also produce hormones that perform many functions in the body, one of which is regulating blood pressure, and they can also produce glucose if necessary given a period of going without food. The last organ system we need to review is the reproductive system, which varies considerably in form between men and women. The female reproductive system consists of ovaries, uterine or fallopian tubes, the uterus or womb, cervix, vagina or birth canal, mammary glands, and the external genitalia, collectively referred to as the vulva or pudendum, which includes the mons pubis, prepuce, clitoris, labia majora, labia minor, vestibule, and perineum. The purpose of the reproductive system is just that, to reproduce or create offspring. Unlike the male reproductive system, however, the female reproductive system is specialized for receiving male gametes, fertilization of the female gamete, which are also known as oocytes or eggs, gestation of the fetus, and delivery of the baby. The male reproductive system includes a scrotum, testes, epididymis, ductus differentia, also known as the vas differentia, ejaculatory ducts, urethra, penis, and some accessory glands like the seminal vesicles, prostate gland, and bulbourethral or Cowper glands. The reproductive system in the male is designed for producing sex cells, male gametes or sperm, and delivering them to the female for egg fertilization. As you may have noticed, the functioning of these various body systems are very complex and they are also interrelated. The survivability of the whole organism, the person, requires all of these various organ systems to work together. Again, later modules will delve into these various organ systems in significantly greater depth. While you may not yet have many of the details of just how these systems function, given your completion of this module, you should now be able to distinguish between body organ systems. This presentation was prepared by Waukesha County Technical College in Pewaukee, Wisconsin, and is distributed with an attribution non-commercial share-alike 4.0 International Creative Commons license. Copyright 2019 Waukesha County Technical College. For information on WCTC's numerous fire and EMS educational offerings, please visit us online at wctc.edu.